My name is Laird Klingler. I'm a librarian with the Cornish Historical Society, and the date is November 9th, 2016. We're at the home of Stuart and Maury Hodgman, and we're here for an interview for the Historical Society of Cornish. And this film is being directed and produced by Billy Scharf. Stuart and Maury, thank you for having us in your home. As a point of reference, I always like to start with, if I may, where and when were you born? And
I was born here in 1940, in September 7th, 1940, and I was actually born at the Mary Hitchcock Memorial Hospital, which has now been changed to Lebanon, but it was in Hanover at the time, and I grew up in the other section of this current house, yeah, all my early years, yeah.
Maury?
Yes, I was born in Crosby, North Dakota, the first in my family to be born in a hospital. So they always felt I was a little spoiled from the beginning because I was born in a hospital. The others were born at home, but that was in North Dakota.
Well, we want to get to North Dakota later on to see how you got from North Dakota to Cornish, you know, but well, both of you, starting with Stuart, can you tell us about this home in particular, this house?
Yes, this the original house where we say I was grew up in was the chauffeur's cottage for the Lang Estate home up on the hill, which we will make reference to later, I'm sure. But this house and the farm on the corner was owned by Albion Lang. My folks married in 35, and they purchased this house at that time and started their New Year's together here, and this is where I grew up. My little world here in Cornish, we're right on the line here with Plainfield. The mailbox up here is in Plainfield, and this portion is in Cornish. So my schooling and all my activities and everything were in this neighborhood, to include Plainfield Village, down the hill on Lang Road, and of course, me being an only child, I spent a lot of time on the corner with the Perry family, which in my upbringing, they were a family of six, ultimately, with the father and the mother. Francis Perry worked at Cones in Windsor. The girls and two boys, four girls and two boys, and I grew up together here in this section of town. So I spent a lot of time over there. And
we went to Tracy School.
And we went to school.
I want to ask you later about the school, if I
okay.
could. But right. I know you also knew the Percy Mackay's children, too.
I did. Percy Mackay was part of the Cornish Colony establishment at the turn of the century, and his home is just the next home in Plainfield on the left-hand side down here. Yes, Johnny Michael, his daughters, Percy Mackay's daughter, Johnny Michael and Marion, his sister, and we grew up together and played back and forth. And during activities in the afternoon, Papa, as they called him, would need a nap. So we were schooled that you must be quiet in the afternoon when you play or go away because Papa's having his nap. Oh yeah, he was quite a.
He was very well known, of course.
He was very well known, and of course,
famous dramatist, poet.
Yes, and had activities at St. Gaudens and all those that we know of about the Golden Bowl and such.
Yes,
and didn't he call upon your father as well?
Well, yes, my dad was kind of a tradesman, a man of all trades, and part of that was keeping the Percy Mackay place winterized and opened up in the spring when they came back from New York, where they spent the winters. Nobody ever wintered over here particularly because it wasn't set up for that. So he would start and stop the water that came off the hill and so on and so forth, and kept the maintenance of the place up and good. So on.
Now you have, through your mother, you have a link to the Tracy family, and the Tracys were one of the early settlers of Cornish. According to the child's history, they came here in 1783, 1784. And I'd like to ask Maury.
Yes.
I know Maury is very well versed in this. You don't have to go back to 1783, but perhaps the 20th century. Tell us a little bit, about Priscilla as a Tracy and the Tracy family around here.
Very definitely. Well, it's certainly all centered around that farm down on Lang Road, the Tracy farm. And as we know, that has been in the family for at least 200 years plus. But Priscilla's grandfather was Stephen Tracy. Stephen and Agnes had a number of children, and I have a picture of all of that. But that was her grandfather, and her father then was William Tracy, who was also born on that Tracy farm, who was the brother of Charles Alden Tracy. And there were several girls and two or three boys, but they all grew up on that Tracy farm. And Priscilla's father was among them, William. And then he married Pearl Hadley from the village, and they later moved into another of the Tracy farms across the road. And that's where Priscilla grew up. But they always had affiliation with the aunts and the grandparents who lived on Tracy Farm. And in fact, Stuart Jr., Stuart was often down at the farm as just a visitor with his mother, and then later was hired by the elderly aunts to do lawn mowing, and so he had the friendship and support of the Tracy farm. Then later, when Stephen, Anne's father and mother, moved back from Nashua and restored the farm, and then a wonderful friendship continued between Priscilla and her cousin Steve and Dorothy. And then in later years, we've so enjoyed the friendship of cousin Anne. So there are many generations of Tracys and friendships. But yes, Priscilla was the daughter of William, who was born and grew up on that farm.
Now the present, the Robbins home?
Yes.
Now, which home? Where?
That was it. That also was a Tracy
Now, is that
farm.
Where?
And that's where Priscilla grew up.
She grew up there.
Yes, and I have a wonderful memoir of one of her brothers of growing up on that Cornish place, so I'll share that with you someday. But they did go to KUA under Uncle Charles, who was the headmaster, and she told many stories about the strictness of it, but she thrived, as did her brother Richard at KUA. But the Aunt Grace was a teacher there as well, the wife of Uncle Charles. And Uncle Charles not only was a headmaster, but he was a justice of the peace, and therefore Priscilla and Herbert were married on the lawn of Tracy Farm with Uncle Charles officiating.
Well, your wife is well versed. Would you like to add anything?
She is, because she and my mother were very close. And I'm sure my mother gave her stories that I never heard of, but she remembers all of the lineage. And it's worth pointing out that in this process, I am the 11th generation from the bond of John Alden and Priscilla Mullins of the Mayflower era.
The 11th?
Yes, 11th generation. So it goes back, and it's fun to track all that stuff. And one of the cousins of my mother was a member of the Mayflower Society and all that. So I guess we have that potential, but we haven't cashed in on that one yet. Anyway, it's interesting stuff. It's but like I say, my mother tutored Mari in a lot of stories and things that went out here.
Yes.
And we were close to Steve and Dorothy, and Steve helped us with some carpentry here. The part of the section of the original house that we upgraded, he designed and helped build here back in the 80s, because he was an architect. So we enjoyed Steve and Dorothy and Anne and her brother and her sister Barb.
Now, well, while you were very young, I'd like you to tell us about a famous or infamous incident that took place not too far from here, just across the road, relating to the Lang home.
Yes, well, that was in 1945. The mansion, as it was affectionately called, the Albion Lang Estate Mansion, burned. And it was alleged to have been arson. And I was 5 years old, so I don't recall a cent of it. I don't remember any of it. I hear a lot of stories. My Uncle Lionel was involved, and you know, all the folks in town were involved in trying to put out the fire. It was a windy night in the fall, and the shakes on the side were blowing all over the valley here, down into Plainfield, and so they were putting fires out miles away from this fire up here, and it destroyed the place. The building itself is very similar to the Admiral Folger place down on Platte Road, which we drive by every day. As a matter of fact, Albion Lang's sister was married to the Admiral. And so that connection there, that building is very similar to the one that burned. Now, my dad was a deputy sheriff among many other trades, but he was involved, of course, and he found the next morning this gentleman from New Jersey who had purchased the property from the Lang estate. And apparently he had put insurance on it and burned it. Now, it was a great lengthy trial in Newport at Circuit Court that lasted a month, and the investigation of it. My dad found the gentleman in the Perry barn next door the next morning, and he was there with his bicycle and so forth, and of course pleaded innocent to all allegations. But they found accelerant, they found all kinds of clues that the reservoirs, the springs in the area up there, which there are numerous, were all drained. And there were quite a number of clues. And there were some kind of water tests that were done. But in the long run, all of the evidence was negated by this dual lawyers from New Jersey that came and sprung him from the whole thing. And so he was never pinned with the thing. He went away back home to New Jersey, took his $80,000 in insurance, which I believe was the amount that he had put on it, and was never heard of again. The Perry family, which I make reference to, the next door neighbors, they had kept that property up because they had farm area and fields along, so it all hooked there. And so they used it for pasture, and there was a water well that they used, and used the fields over here. So he paid the taxes every year, all the way from 45. Mr. Perry did, all the way then till 1980, when I purchased it, because they sold their portion of the farm and moved to 5 acres over here, which used to be a part of that parcel. And I told him at the time, I said, well, if you plan to sell that property, I'd like to be involved in it and have an opportunity. So I did, in fact, purchase 80 acres of that property. And,
but they had claimed it legally after so many years.
They had it. They got it by deed, by adverse possession, through the courts, advertised where the last known location of the gentleman was in New Jersey. Nobody ever came back or discussed it again. So that's kind of the mystery of the whole thing. Where did he go? Why did he do it? Of course, I just go by stories that I hear. I don't have any firsthand knowledge of it.
Well, you have a link with your father.
Of course, and my dad was involved with it.
Yeah. I've seen the foundations. Yeah. It must have been a magnificent mansion.
As a matter of fact, the bricks in that fireplace backing there came from the chimneys of that mansion up there.
That's right. Billy, can you get that?
One of the major chimneys is still there, and we do have picnics, and we have enjoyed the property now for many years. Yeah. But it shows that because the Perrys were faithful in paying the taxes.
And the bricks came from the Lang Mansion?
Yes.
They did.
That's fascinating.
Yes.
Because there had been 3 chimneys, and see, some had fallen down into the cellar area, so those we picked up and cleaned off and used.
And then his leg would have gone down the Lang Road, I assume.
Yes, well, it included that 90 acres over there, and then The acreage here abutting Colleen's.
Colleen O'Neill is now preserving the land, yes. Owns of it, yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
I love it.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So, yes. So Lang himself owned property in both towns.
Both towns.
Yeah. And he was a well-to-do gentleman that at the time of the turn of the century, it's the same time that Maxfield Parrish was building his place, and it's been said that Maxfield says, well, I can never find any decent masons around because they're all over at the Lang place. Because there are numerous walls and stone facades up there that were made in 1906. Our house, our original house here is a 1912 vintage. So, but yeah.
Well, moving on just a little in your time, you attended a one-room schoolhouse.
We did.
And tell us about it, your experiences there, and where it was.
Well, my mother went to the same school. It's just below the Tracy Farm, and it was about a mile from this house here. So, yes, I started first grade there, and I spent seven grades at that one-room school with the same teacher, Mrs. Eva Bernard, and she lived in Plainfield, and in the winter time she would stay in Roz Peter Burling's
Edmondson.
Edmondson's place there just behind the school. But anyway, so we would walk to school every day or get a ride down with the parents, either the Perrys or my folks. Or we would slide down the hill in the wintertime, because you could get out here and just shoot down the hill. If you went up just up on Colleen's a little bit, you could go without ever stopping. And in those days, they didn't sand quite as heavily, and so the roads were easily traversed by sled. So that was kind of a neat thing. But yeah, back and forth each day down the hill and back up. Yeah, there were eight grades in the room, and I guess what I recall about it is that the teacher would do her little teaching with each grade separately, and then we would have group efforts, whether it be music or spelling bees or those kinds of things, and on Friday afternoons, we had the Good English Club, where we would either listen to the Boston Pops on the radio, and we would have a discussion of people who had used bad words during the week because there was a monitor watching amongst ourselves. Really? It was kind of cute. And so those activities. At lunchtime, my grandmother, who was in the house that was just described, just up there, the Robbins place, she cooked the hot lunch. So we would have salmon wiggle and chop suey and soup and all these delicious things in this pot that she would make. And a couple of us would walk up the road. It was a quarter of a mile up the road. And we'd bring this big pot down and put it on the stove, which was the wood stove at the front part of the school. That stove, as a matter of fact, is in my basement to keep the basement warm. But so that was our hot lunch, and the teacher would parcel it out, and you would have your own dish, and you were responsible for that and so forth. So and the water, there was no running water, so the water came from the Rogers family down the hill, Peter Burling's place now, where we go down and get a pail of water from the laundry room at the Rogers and bring it up and put it in a porcelain container with our little paper cups, and there you were. And so the facilities for the school, we had the outhouse was in the back, outside, not a part of the building, and girls and boys separate, and in the front part was the woodshed, which and occasionally I got older, and I don't remember which grade I started, but it was middle grade. I started going down in the mornings and sweeping the floor and starting the fire. So that was my chore for a number of years in the wintertime, for sure. My Uncle Lionel did it before I did, because he was the farmer next door. But that was one of my jobs that I did. And speaking of the woodshed, that discipline was not a big thing with Mrs. Bernard, because she just, her demeanor was that you knew that you better behave because Mrs. Bernard wanted you to. And if she had an unruly little kid or whatever, she might give him a whack, but that wasn't the norm. Hmm. If she had, she said, okay, I don't remember the names now, but why don't you go in the woodshed for a little bit? So the woodshed was right there, hooked to the school part, the one room. And so they'd go in there and they'd sulk for a while, and that would be it. Or she had a thing on the blackboard at the top, baby corner. So if you did something silly, stupid, or whatever, she'd get your name in the baby corner. I don't know whether she made us stand in the corner or not, but I can't remember. But that was another. So discipline was not a big deal, really. And we had fun activities. We always had our recess, and we played ball in the spring or whenever there wasn't any mud. We played ante over the roof with the ball and all that business. Hide and seek, tag, the whole thing, all around that building. So.
And the music.
Oh yeah, we had music. My mother was a piano player, and she would come and play the music. Oh. And she also substituted, if Eva, Mrs. Bernard, as we always called her, Mrs. Bernard was ill or whatever, you'd get a call, and my mother would go down and do the day with the kids. And so it's been known that I used to go with her, because she did music before I went to school. So I would tag along. I went everywhere my mother was. And so, but I didn't have to dance or sing because I wasn't in school yet. So I said, okay, I will do that when I get to the first grade. So, but anyway, that's the school experiences. And just a side of that, the fact that I was with my mother, she and I traveled together walking mostly all over this area. She was a member of every organization in Plainfield. And Cornish, Grange, and Ladies' Aid, and Mothers and Daughters Club, and the church, and organist for 28 years, and all that kind of business. But we would go to all these meetings together, because my dad was working either as a postal carrier or whatever he was doing that day. So that aspect of my upbringing is very vivid, because we went with our umbrella with us. Raining or snowing or whatever, because we had one car. So we'd go down the hill. It's 2 miles down to Plainfield
walking.
And back,
mm-hmm.
walking back. That's how you did it.
How soon after that did the consolidation come in
well,
Cornish?
I spent 7 years at Tracy School, and my eighth year was spent in the Plainfield school, which now is the Smith Auction House. And the school, the school had been upgraded, and they built another room on the school that they had there. And the town of Cornish sent all their eighth graders there to that one room. So our teacher was Mr. Lennon, and we had our last year, that was 54, and the Central Consolidated School opened in 55. My dad was very integral in getting that school going.
You know, we have at the center, we have the program for the dedication.
Yeah.
And your father was listed as the master of ceremonies.
He was the MC, yeah.
For that
he was on the school board. He may have been on the selectmen at the same time. He was on both of those boards at one point or another. But he ended up, being the MC of that dedication in 55. It was a bit of a tough go. Going from the one-room schools that we had, because we had six of them in town. There used to be 16. They kept dropping off because they were the number of children dropped off. But in any case, just like in the Yankee or New England way, if it works, why change it? And money, of course, was an issue. They had raised some monies by the beginning of the Cornish Fair situation was a penny sale for that. But getting it to get on the warrant and getting folks behind it was a task.
So there was opposition to
it? Yes, there was. I don't recall specifically, you know, but I know it had to do with money and why do we need to give up these schools that we already have and so forth. But again, we were talking outhouses and those kinds of things, which my dad and I kept up at. When the school was over, we would go around and clean these schools and clean out the outhouses.
Oh, really?
And do all these different things, because my dad was he had many trades. So
he was a landscape director. Yeah.
Well, then you did go on to Windsor High School.
I went to Windsor High because I'm on this side of town, the 12A side. It was just the way they did it, and I believe they had contracts to do that. Mm-hmm. And on the 120 side, they went to Stevens, and it was no fuss or muss about it. As years went on, it changed, and people had choice, which is fine. The first 2 years, I would catch the bus with the neighbor kids down at the Plainfield store. We'd either walk down there or get a ride down there and catch the bus to Windsor. And when they were working on the bridge, which was occasionally on the Cornish-Windsor Bridge, we'd walk through the bridge up to the Windsor High, which is where the town offices are now, up on Scotney Street. Mm-hmm. So,
You know, I'd like you to talk a little bit about the Windsor that you knew at that time and the Windsor that you see today. I imagine people, if for shopping or for entertainment, people would have gone to Windsor. Dale Rook, for example, when we did the interview, said there were two movie theaters in Windsor.
But
talk a little bit about the contrast that you, from
what
you remember.
Well, Windsor was a bustling town. There was a lot of activity. There were two main businesses in town. The Goodyear Rubber Company employed, I believe, 1,500. And the Cone Automatic at one time was up to 3,000, I believe. I mean, there were a lot of, the valley came to Windsor to work. So in the afternoon, when the shift changes, mm-hmm. and lots of times they had three shifts going, for sure two, they'd be switching in the afternoon about 3 or 3:30 or wherever. And they had a policeman at each of those streets that go to the river. Depot Avenue, River Street, and Bridge Street, all those different streets. I don't recall that there was any stoplights anywhere, but they were directing traffic in and coming out of there. And cones came out from the North Main Street exit. And, you know, when you've got that many people hitting the streets of Windsor, it's a busy time. Anyway, there were a lot of stores that were active there. The Maxim store, there was a grocery store, there was the Blue Haven Grill, and all these different places, the news store and all that. So it was a popular, busy place. I don't recall going to the second movie theater, which I think was on River Street, but I went to the one on the corner there where where Larry Nolan's statue is of the soldier. Mm-hmm. There was the theater there. And my dad and I, and sometimes my mother, but he and I used to go to all the Western movies and, you know, and see. I wasn't an every Saturday guy, but when we went, it was an occasion. And I remember I saw an Elvis film there, but
oh, really?
Yeah. So it's but they had the hospital was busy. There was at least well, there was two or three grocery stores. There was the First National and the Price Chopper came, and I mean, there was a lot of activity in Windsor. When the interstate changed, and also when those businesses went away, Goodyear closed, and Cone's ultimately just kind of waned. All that activity changed, and then they built Interstate 91, and the powers to be in Windsor said, we don't want a street coming down, because they proposed to come down State Street with an exit to Windsor. Well, they bypassed that. There's one in the Scutney, and there's one in Hartland.
A big mistake.
And well, it's all how you look at it. I mean, Windsor is still like it was, and I don't know if it affected the Scutney and Hartland that much, but we know that that and I-89 affected Claremont and Lebanon situation, yes. And that's another story in its own.
Sure.
But
Well, after high school, then you went to UNH, and while there, you were in the Air Force ROTC.
Right.
You graduated. You went to flight training school.
I did.
And then you went to Vietnam.
I did.
Tell us about your experiences in Vietnam.
Okay, well, do you care about any of the experiences at UNH?
Well, of course. Okay. Well, I did skip over that, didn't I?
I went to UNH because I said, okay, engineering, I've gotten my sights set on doing some engineering. So I took civil engineering as a course. But in the process, UNH is a land-grant college, and at the time it was mandatory that you take an ROTC for 2 years. 2 years mandatory. That's no longer the case, but and you had a choice of Army or Air Force. So I chose Air Force ROTC, and we faithfully marched every Thursday, and we had classes that was a credit and a half. I think we met at least once, maybe twice a week. And learned about the history of the Air Force and so on and so forth. I was a member of the drill team and got involved with the Air Force activities. And as time went on, and they give you an opportunity after the first two mandatory years to continue on in and get a commission from that program. And one of the motivations was, they said, well, why don't you take this test and we'll see if you qualify for whatever. And I qualified for pilot and so on, and I took a physical at Pease and all that. So it just kind of went along, and I liked the 3 credit A's that I was getting from the ROTC, and I really enjoyed it. So it all just, at the end of my academic period there, when I got my degree, you have an opportunity to take a commission as a second lieutenant. You don't have to take it, even though you've spent this time at it. If you didn't take it, you would be on the top of the list for being drafted or heading off. And of course, in those days, 63 at the time, Vietnam was starting to get going, and I would have been drafted right away. So I never gave that a thought. I never even thought about doing it that way. I took the commission and went off to pilot training.
You know, if I could interrupt you here for a second, I forgot to mention one thing which relates to your Air Force training. While you were in high school, you were very active at something like the Civil Air Patrol.
That's true.
So that fits into your later work, but just mention a little bit about that, because we have a picture of you receiving an award,
yeah,
you know, at the center for that.
Well, we're talking 50s now. I think I was 14 when I really got active in it, and Mrs. Perry, as I keep mentioning the Perrys, she was very involved in the Ground Observer Corps. And the Ground Observer Corps was set up to help the protection of the skies and the area and the states from foreign airplanes and so forth. I mean, we were in the period of atom bombs and ducking under your desk
in
the whole business. Yeah. So Ground Observer Corps was created here by several local folks. And what we did until before we got our observer building, we would go up on the Jordan Hill Alice Jordan and Billy Jordan's place. We used that quite often. Or you could do it from your own place if you had to. When you heard an airplane, you would go out with your binoculars, look up and see what airplane it was, how many engines, what directions it was going, and how high you thought it was. You would come in, call the central tracking facility in Manchester, and you dial them up and you say, okay, I have a multi-engine aircraft heading northwest to southeast at about 30,000 feet, making contrails or not, or whatever. And our call sign was Coco Papa 43 Black. So when you said that, they would know where you were. They would plot that airplane on the board, which you've seen in World War II movies with their sticks and so forth. They would plot that aircraft, and it would be picked up by other ground observer units. So we had dances, Woody and the Rambler dances, and Donnie McClay and company, and all those guys. We would have dances to earn money, and we made enough money to build our own observer. It was up on stilts, and it was down on the Plainfield Plain where those condos are now. And so we'd go down there and pull a hitch every once in a while. I can't remember when it waned. I mean, I went off to college, and so it ended in the late 50s.
Well, it's all part of the Air Force.
Yeah. And in the process, we got a tour of that facility in Manchester. We got a ride in a C-47 and went to Wright-Patterson Air Force Base in Ohio, which, as a country guy, that was big stuff for me to get in an airplane and fly off to some place I've never been.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, now let's go to Vietnam now.
Okay. So, anyway, after my time, I should touch on the civil engineering aspect. Had I not done this Air Force business and gone in the service, I probably would have been an engineer with the state of New Hampshire, because during the summers, during college, I worked on the highways locally with the local engineer, the state engineer. I worked on I-89, the road that runs from Hanover to Lyme, the Plainfield Village. We widened that whole thing, a road in Claremont and so forth, for the 4 summers that I was after school in the summertime. So that was but I never got back into the civil engineering world again, which Maury sometimes says, well, we should have, but I didn't. Anyway, we pick up and go to the Air Force. I graduated in June of 63, and my class, and I was selected for pilot training, and my class started in November in Valdosta, Georgia, Moody Air Force Base. So in my 63 Fastback Corvette, I drove to Valdosta, Georgia, and started pilot training. And it was a tough year. They have two kinds of airplanes that you trained in, the T-37 and then the T-38. I was fortunate enough to be the first one to solo in the T-38 in the class that I started with. It was a new airplane, the T-38. And so I soloed first in my class there in that airplane, and subsequently got an assignment to a fighter, the F-4 Phantom. And from Moody, I went to training in the F-4 in Tucson, Arizona, at Davis-Monthan Air Force Base for, well, it was January to about April of 64, 65. And then from there, I went to MacDill Air Force Base in Florida, Tampa, Florida, joined up with a group of and a squadron. There were two wings there, 3 squadrons in each wing at MacDill. That unit was called to go to Vietnam en masse, which we did in 1965. In November of 1965, I went to Cam Ranh Bay, Vietnam, and spent 11 months there. flying the F-4. We were what we called early Cameron because they had just opened the base. They had just put down an aluminum runway on the sand there on the beach. It was a beautiful sight, a nice place. We lived in a Quonset hut, and all together there were probably 65 or 70 of us all in this Quonset hut. Ultimately, we divided them up into roommate-type places. But in any case, early Cameron, and I flew 250 missions in Vietnam, Laos, Cambodia, North Vietnam, all of that area, all of which, at the time, we weren't flying in Laos and Cambodia and those places.
And that These are all bombing missions?
Yes. I had 505 combat hours doing that. We were sent there to support the Army in close air support, which is you're guided in either by a smoke rocket or by directions from somebody on the ground or in the air telling you hit that point over there or whatever by their direction. That's close air support. That was all South Vietnam stuff. I would say less than half of those 250 missions were in South Vietnam. A lot of missions were in Laos, trying to knock out that trail that they had made down from the North Vietnam through Laos and circumventing coming in by Saigon and all that business. Lots of different stories about that. I never got shot down. I never jumped out of the F-4.
I was going to ask you, did you have any close calls
well,
when you were there?
I guess it's all relative. I lost an engine. I heard it was a 50 caliber shot. It went into the right engine, down the engine, engine unwinds. We were near the coast, so it wasn't an issue of trying to fight your way out. We just went out over the water. Went back home one engine because we had two engines on it and we had redundant hydraulics and all this kind of business. So we were able to get back home. And you would get bullet holes in the airplane frequently. I mean, it would be from things you never saw. I mean, we would stay up at least 4,500 feet above so that somebody just sit down there and shoot straight up and you'd fly through the bullet or whatever. If they shot enough of them up there. So anyway, you would get hit on occasion. There were some folks who didn't make it. I lost seven compatriots out of the squadron when we were there. They weren't all combat losses. Some of them were weather issues, pilot errors, things, but there were some combat kills from the squadron.
Did you have any missions going into North?
I did. We used to escort various airplanes that were up there with radar, keeping track and controlling things that were going on up there. We had a number of missions that included escorting those folks high cover with missiles to go after MiGs. I never did go after a MiG. I saw them on the radar and I saw them couple times visually, but never did have to do that. I did not. I dropped bombs in Package One, as they called it, north of Da Nang, in North Vietnam. But when you hear of North Vietnam, you hear of downtown Hanoi, and when the B-52s were there in the 70s, I didn't go to Hanoi downtown. We were out by Haiphong, out over the water, and near Haiphong. So yeah, I had 30 some missions up there. And matter of fact, that resulted in 1 month being taken off my tour. Because if you got 100 missions in North Vietnam, you went home. That's how they differentiated South Vietnam and North Vietnam missions. So I got 250, 30 of which were in the North.
But 250 total missions, though.
Yes. The thing about what was there to do when you were at Cameron Bay, I mean, you could eat or go swimming in the ocean, which was right there, or fly. So I mostly slept or flew. We had activities. Another guy and I designed an officer's club, and we built an officer's club as a group, a squadron group, because there weren't any facilities there. There were just tents. So we built a nurses club, rudimentary as it was.
Tell about doing your laundry. I thought that was interesting.
Oh, yeah. We didn't initially have any washing machines. And we didn't. So we ended up having to do our laundry in ammo cans. So here you are, slugging away on your on your flight suit or whatever, your goodies. Yeah. But we did, the first sergeants and the support folks were just marvelous. I mean, they made things happen. And we got it squared away fairly soon.
Well, after Vietnam, then you went to Germany, and Maury, I think this is where you entered the picture.
That's right.
So maybe you can explain how you two met, and well, how did you end up in Germany from North Dakota?
Well, I think I'll have to credit my sixth grade teacher, because she was so good teaching about the Roman gods and goddesses, and I knew someday I'm going there and run around those rooms. So I always wanted to go to Europe, and I graduated from Teachers College and University, and I had taught
in North Dakota?
Yes, in North Dakota. And then I got my first teaching assignment in California, and then I taught again in North Dakota and in Washington State, where I found out about this wonderful program. The Department of Defense hires teachers to teach families who are overseas, and they have wonderful schools, and so I was hired to teach with the Department of Defense for military schools overseas. And so I was teaching, and lo and behold, there were single people there too, and I didn't know that. And Stuart, among many other pilots, was there. So I say I met him through an uncle, Uncle Sam.
Target-rich environment, as we would call it.
Excuse me, I think it's only appropriate that, you know, we're talking about all of this, and I don't know if you can pick this up, but this is the environment. That's the plane.
Let's see if I can get this right here. How's that, Billy?
Yeah, that's what I have for.
Okay, and that really is the story. And it's kind of cute because it was a wonderful large school, and I think it's nice to share this. These military schools, and I was assigned to the one in Germany, are really very lovely. It's like teaching in a private school. And there are military schools at many of these bases that are called accompanied tours that can be as much as 3 and 4 years, you see, and that's why the families are also moved to be with their military person. But anyway, so I was teaching at the military school in Bitburg, Germany, and we tell the story that the gentlemen teachers who were on our staff, when we'd be out on the playground for recess, would look up and see these F-4 jets going over, and they'd say, "I sure wish I had one of those." And we female teachers would look up and say, "I wish I had one of those pilots flying one of those." But anyway, we tease that if you can't have a wonderful relationship when your weekends are spent exploring castles and beautiful places in Europe, you know, so it was Rome and Paris. It's a wonderful thing for teachers to do, to have that opportunity. So I like traveling. I like doing those things. So our relationship then for the next 20 years was traveling to different places in the Air Force.
Yeah, see,
and I enjoyed it very much.
My first 7 years was as a bachelor. So she didn't have to experience the Vietnam separation and all that business. And so 7 years worth, I was on my own. But I was the lucky guy because she supported me in all my ventures after we were married, because I went on and was a flight commander and squadron commander and made full colonel and went on to the headquarters. And the Air Force always expects that they're going to get two for one. They get the guy in the job, and they also get the wife. And Maury pitched in on all occasions to help with all
families.
The activities with
families.
The families and the wives, because the pilots that I had under my guys in the squadron and such, we would go off to Korea or off to Nellis Air Force Base in Nevada.
Africa,
for
Italy.
Africa, all over. TDY, as we call it, and the girls are all left home. So
on the base.
Oh yeah,
with the kids.
Yeah, at the base where we were stationed. So we had young Stuart. Soon after we got to Texas, it was in 73. But I left a teaching pilot training job there, where Stuart was born in Laredo, and within a month, I was off going to Korea because they closed the base. So Mari and Stuart, young little Stuart, had to spend that year that I was a remote tour in Korea, in Cheyenne, Wyoming, where her sister was, which was a nice setup, and it worked fine. But as those kind of family upheavals and extra duties that the wives have to take on when us fighter pilots and all this, you know, the military guys take off and go do their thing.
And so, it was so fortunate then, though, because your, we call those remote tours of duty, were spaced. Now, many young military families go through that every few months.
Yeah. You hear about the tours to Afghanistan and Iraq, mm-hmm. and all those. Mm-hmm. On my third tour, fourth tour, some of these Army guys have been there half a dozen times.
We didn't do that.
So
mm-hmm.
it's really
changed.
It's hard. Mm-hmm. But
You once told me a very interesting story about your career. As an enlisted man, you were what we used to call a full bird, full bird colonel. And the next step would have been to be a general.
That's correct.
Now, you made a conscious decision not to pursue that. And I thought that was very interesting. Tell us about that.
My whole interest and where I excelled was flying. I had a lot of jobs that required standardization, evaluation, and those kinds of things. So that was important to me. And I enjoyed it. And I did have tours in commands lower than the Pentagon. And what you're getting at is, in order to be a general officer, you got to be involved in the administration, usually a flyer. If he gets past 12 years of actually flying in the unit without getting to the Pentagon, you're lucky. But I elected not to do that. I had my mentors were saying, Stuart, you need to go to the Pentagon so you can round out your career and get on with these different things. But I elected not to because they didn't fly airplanes there. I did my tours of in major command headquarters. I went to the Tactical Air Command headquarters three times, but two out of those three times I was flying airplanes. I was either in charge of inspecting airplanes. That's how I got to fly not only the F-4, but the F-15, the F-16, the RF-4, and I flew in a number of Air Force aircraft that I didn't pilot, but I was evaluating their what they were doing. And in my tour in Canada, I flew the F-18. So, I mean, That's fighter pilot stuff, and that's what I enjoyed doing. So that was my conscious decision, because you're betting that, I'll give my pound of flesh, so to speak, and go to the staff. There's no guarantee you're going to be a general officer. And so I just
plus didn't. Our family life by that time, you see, Stuart Jr. was graduating from high school. And Nana was with us, but was ready to come home. So it was time to go get our son started in college and for us to get on with the next phase of our life.
So then you retired. Then you came back here.
I did.
Yes, yeah. Yes. Now, Maury, did you teach here in town?
Yes, I did.
In Plainfield? Or?
That's the other part. You see, once you retire from the military and we arrived here, we had a son starting college, and we were going to build a sizable addition, so somebody had better hit the ground working. And he wanted to help with the building and get the place ready, so I was very grateful that I indeed interviewed and was hired right away out at Goshen Lempster School. And it was a wonderful opportunity. Mm. So I taught for 7 years out there, And then I taught for 6 years in Lebanon, and it was all wonderful. I loved it.
Now, during this time, I know you were involved in real estate. One time I saw you in a bank. I think you had a bank job for a while. But I think the thing that we would want to focus on is you're a selectman. And I'd like to pay you a compliment. I recently visited Al Stevens, you know, after his wife died. And there was a time that Crea Barn across from their house was going to be destroyed. I think the fire department was going to use it for
exercise. They were going to have a practice.
And Al said, Marie went to talk to Stuart. And Stuart said, you go ahead. If you get the money, you can go ahead and save the Crea Barn. So Al was very complimentary to you. But but tell us about some of the other issues that you dealt with on the select board.
She went to work, and I need to make a point that it was commendable that she drove 35 miles each way to go to
our collision Lampster. But it was fun. I liked it.
Summer, winter, good weather or not. Yeah, I came home, and I did H&R Block taxes, I did Century 21 real estate, and I did Vermont National Bank and Chittenden Bank teller. And it was all fun. It was meeting people and doing stuff. But interspersed there, I did 9 years of selectmen. I did two tours, three years apiece, back to back, and then I took a break, and then I did another three. I started at the History Center was the Selectman's office.
Oh, you were there. You
and
were
that's
there.
Where I started out.
On School Street.
In
1994,
On School Street. And it was Bob Maslin and John White and me. And so we could see that we were right away. I replaced Mike Yatsevich, who was the venerable selectman in town. He was at over 30 years worth of selectmen. And so Virginia Colby, a name that's familiar in town, said, Stuart, you need to do that. So she was kind of my sponsor to get going. And she had a gathering and invited people and said, here's Stuart, he needs to be our selectman, so you vote for him. So
I thought it was neat, though, that am I correct that Mike Yatsevich had also served with your father when he was selectman?
They were selectmen together.
So he thought it was only right also. He said, now I'm leaving, and I served when your father was selectman, and now you're back, so now you can't be selectman.
So we're passing the baton. Anyway, there was not enough room to do business at the History Center or the selectman's office, and there'd been some talk of doing it. So I enjoyed working with the guys, and we were offered an opportunity to move the office down to where it is now. It was the old Grange Hall, and Polly Tierney was the one that instigated that. She was a member of the Grange there, and Polly Manette is Mike Manette's mom. She was the involved, maybe master, I don't know. But anyway, the town, we bought, gave them a dollar, and they said, here, it's your place. We want to have our meetings upstairs, so you can have the whole first floor. So that's what the first endeavor that I was involved in. So I think for around $150,000, we renovated the bottom floor of the old Grange Hall and made offices, and has been worked on since, and the Grange is no longer there. And the other aspect was that the highway garage was really nothing to adequate at all. It had open barn, and it was along Paget Road there, along the side near where the building is now. So for another $150,000, we built the current highway garage that's there in town now. So those two projects, along with a lot of other little things that we did, we put signs on all four corners of the town, which they're going to upgrade, by the way. Those aspects were fun for me. I enjoyed listening to folks who would come in, usually with some kind of ire, saying, well, you either didn't plow this right, or you dug up my yard, or you know, all these different things. And after 9 years, you hear that repetitive. I mean, it's fun to try to solve people's concerns, because it's too easy not to. And some folks didn't quite understand how the budget worked, because that's what the main job of the selectman is to do the town business and monitor those monies that have been appropriated at town meeting, and don't overspend it. So whatever the budget was, we had to make sure that it was allocated such that the road guy didn't go over and we'd move money around or whatever to make it all happen. And some folks would come in and say, you guys, you're spending too much money, and how come we can't do this, and this costs too much, and whatever. And I would take some folks aside and say, look, we monitor the money. You vote what you want to spend. We don't cook up numbers and create numbers to be spent. We might advocate for certain things, but you folks are the ones that decide whether we're going to spend it or not. So that was an education for a number of people in town that I enjoyed trying to tell them about, because I see, I get it. So we have control over it. Anyway.
Well, I know you've been involved in other activities, but we should mention also that you are now the president of the Cornish Historical Society.
Yeah, and I started going there. Maury and I were life members, and I can't remember when we started up. But the reason being, the Cornish Historical Society was created prior to the bicentennial in the 70s. About 73, some folks, to include Steve Tracy and Virginia Colby and a number of other folks, that were starting to work on the bicentennial aspect of that celebration. And they said, well, where's this history stuff? And I don't know the details of all that, but anyway, Steve and Virginia and some folks created the Cornish Historical Society at that time. And Steve architected and redesigned the meeting house as a place for that society to meet. So the open space when you come into the meeting house is where the meeting started for the Historical Society, and that room that you have graciously upgraded recently was where the exhibits were, and that was the only place that we had it located at that time. So I joined and went to a number of meetings there. Jim Atkinson came to town, and he got involved with Virginia, both in writing Footprints of the Past book, and she passed the baton to him as the president. By the way, Virginia was kind of elected president in absentia when she was away. The trustees, the only reason I know that is Caroline Storrs mentioned that to me. But anyway, and Jim did that for almost 20 years. And the Rooks, matter of fact, Judy Rook, came to me and said, how about you be the president? And she was recruiting at the time. So I did agree to do that. And since then, it's approaching 5 years, or it's about 5 years or so. And we've had a good time doing that. I would say your coming on board and agreeing to help us has been like these projects, and getting things on the computer and getting things organized in three venues, as a matter of fact, upstairs in the selectman's office, at the meeting house, and of course the History Center is commendable on your part.
Well, thank you.
We appreciate it.
Thank you.
I'd like to insert something about when the 9/11 signs. Have I got that right? When you can call 911?
Yeah, 911.
Okay. When Stuart and I first met, I was living in a BOQ on the base, and my room number was 206. 206. Some years later, when we moved again to Valdosta, Georgia in the Air Force, we bought a house, and lo and behold, the address was 206. When the edict came that now we are going to have addresses on our country homes. And okay, so you get a letter in the mail and it tells you what your address is. Would you believe when we opened that envelope, we are 206.
Oh, you didn't ask for it.
Dodge Road.
Three.
I thought the story was leading up to the fact that
right.
you asked for the 206.
And no, we said, no. Well, I think it means we're supposed to be here.
Yeah, that's how they measure it so far.
Right.
Well, I think we're pretty close to the end, but I did want to ask you, Stuart, since you've been here almost all your life, would you comment on some of the changes that you've seen in Cornish? And for better, for worse, are there things you miss from the past? Or
well, old Cornish that I grew up in was a slow pace. The roads didn't have gravel that was good. It was mud. My dad used to deliver mail, and he had to use the Model A truck to get around because the roads were so bad. So we've gone from that type of road structure, 52 miles of dirt road, to roads that are commendable today. And as far as sanding and clear and all that kind of stuff, we've come a long way in the mechanics. The family farms have dissipated. We've had a number of farms. Even the Perrys had cows, and that's where I got milk. That's how I grew up, on raw milk. We'd just go over and get our quart of milk a day and so forth. So the family small aspect of it, the gardens, everybody had their own little garden. So the neighborly aspect has changed, I think. A lot of the older families have either moved away or they're died off. We've had an influx of folks from what we affectionately call Flatlanders. Folks come up to New Hampshire. New Hampshire's a beautiful state, and Cornish is a unique town because of the history and Cornish colony and all that aspect. Some well-known people have lived here. And so it is a calling. We have St. Gaudens Memorial, the whole thing. So what has occurred, we've gotten the central school, which is more modern. The prices of doing business and the services that people want have made the taxes come up, the value of properties come up. Some of the rules that we have in town doesn't allow for small lots. There's a lot of current use going on, so that's different from what it was when I was a kid. When I was a kid, we didn't worry about all that kind of stuff, and it was just regular. But I think we're having a stress on our schools right now, on our school. I hope it remains here. We need the school to make a town be a town. You got to have a school to draw. And I think that'll come back around. So that's, you know, I guess things go in cycles, and I think it'll cycle back, I'm sure. It's a wonderful place to live, and I can't imagine having to live in the big city.
Maury, I wonder if we might conclude, and I might ask you a favor. I think I see a picture over there. Is that a younger picture of you and Stuart?
Yes.
Maybe Billy, we could...
I caught
my eye on that. Now, where is this picture?
That actually is our honeymoon in Paris.
Oh, is it really? Let's see, Billy. Yes.
That's the Moulin Rouge. 1970. Moulin Rouge in Paris.
I picked that up, and then so.
Right. I think we should finish though with also a picture of our son and his children, who also like coming to Cornish.
Yeah.
Stuart Jr. and his wife Laurie,
who live in North Carolina,
and Avery and Emmy. That's right. So the Hodgmans enjoy Cornish.
We're proud of those kids.
Well, I really very much enjoyed it for the interview, and thank you for inviting us into your home. And Billy, as they like to say in the movies, this is a take.